Let's talk about magic. Hey everyone, welcome back to my channel. My name is Brittany Simon. Thank you for being on today's podcast with me. Today we are working with a company called High Priestess. So this is their little box that you can see here. Can I explain to you the amazing energy I feel when I'm working with the people at this company? I just feel very grounded and very seen. Actually, in order to do this podcast, I actually ran around my house and picked up all the things that I've collected over the years that represented my belief in magic, which is not really a belief in magic so much as a hope in magic, but not literal magic like Harry Potter, but sort of. Anyways, we're gonna dive into it, but before we start, let's talk about the tea of the day. This tea actually came in this box. So it's a perfect win-win. It's a hibiscus tea. Look at the ingredients. One ingredient, organic hibiscus flowers. Perfect, 100%. That's what I love to see. This is a company called Black Leaves, and they're from Australia. So it's a nice little tea. You guys know every week on this podcast, I talk about a tea or drink I'm, you know, enjoying. This is definitely one of them. And to drink this delicious tea, I am using the mug that came in the High Priestess box. Yum! And I added in a little honey. Okay, I'm going to move this to the side because I want to show you that today we'll be looking at a few items I keep around to kind of help me explore my spiritual side, my magical side, my intuition side. To go along with that theme, obviously I wanted to light a candle. This candle is also from High Priestess, and this candle is sitting on top of a rock that I found outside because I collect rocks, and I am afraid it's going to spill wax on my table. So if that happens, I might have to change positions, but let's hope for the best. I'm also wearing a cuff from the High Priestess box that I actually, and I have some close-up footage at the end of this podcast, so definitely if you're listening on Spotify, stick around to see the more in-depth opening and displaying of the items in the box because it is such a good box. Like, I have subscribed to so many box services, but this one is so good. It's worth every penny. Everything is so quality. I am so impressed. I am in love with every item, and there's so many. When I was unboxing it, I was like, okay, how many items are in this box? So many items. But this cuff in particular is not only nice and heavy and dense, but it makes me feel so solid in my upper body. You guys know lately I've been really focusing on my upper body presentation versus in the past I think I would recoil when things were a little difficult. I've learned to really stand strong, and I think my spiritual journey really was a part of that. So I really think it's important that when we're having this conversation that you know that I'm not trying to diminish your beliefs. I'm not trying to say that I have the objective truth. I'm just trying to make it clear that I do believe in energy, and I do believe in spiritual exploration, and I do believe it is accessible for all people, religious or not religious. You guys know I'm from the United States. I was raised Catholic by immigrant parents from Iraq, and Catholicism is a very symbolic and ritualistic belief system. It's a very interesting religion. It has a lot of ups and downs, and it's complicated. But over the years, I have stayed connected to the art and symbolism of Catholicism, while maintaining that I currently do not believe in a god, though I am open to a higher being existing. I don't know that they do or do not. So you can call me an atheist or agnostic. I feel it's all accurate in different ways. But to my left, I have some examples of Catholic symbolism that I keep around my house. This is Mother Mary and Jesus. This is an infant of Prague, also Jesus. And the infant of Prague symbolizes sort of like wealth and abundance to some extent, or rather, if you pray to him, have him around your home, it helps with like jobs and financial wealth. So my mom always gives her kids infant of Prague's. And then this cross I actually got from one of you many, many years ago. One of you sent it to me, and I think you're supposed to put like holy water here in the little bottom part. But this cross has stayed with me for so long, and I love it so much. It's just, it's humble, it's beautiful, it's imperfect, and therefore it is perfect to me. So whoever sent this to me, I still have it. I'm pretty sure I still have your letter because I always save my letters from everybody. But this is beautiful to me. And I think it came from, I don't remember what country you were in, but I know it was somewhere really interesting and unique. And I thought to myself, I really want to visit. So I don't know where it was from exactly. But I keep these around to remind me of my roots and to remind me that I had changed and I've grown. Now, because I don't literally believe in magic, it's hard for me when people ask me questions like, have you ever had anything supernatural happen to you? My mom always asks me that. Betsy, have you ever had something happen to you supernatural? Have you ever seen like a demon or seen something in the dark? And I'm like, well, you know, I do drugs. So I think we need to ask the question a different way. But I think the question she's asking me is, have I ever experienced something where I really felt like, ooh. And to be honest, my answer has always been no. But recently I came in contact with somebody through my Patreon one-on-one calls. P.S. Definitely hit me up for a call. I'm currently closed for December, but we are taking January appointments. So email me at calls with Brittany Simon if you're interested. Also, I'd like to point out how my wax is doing. Fingers crossed that it does not get all over the table, but it's very pretty. Okay, so I talked to this human and we had a good conversation. And the other day he said, oh, that's like supernatural. And I was like, wait, what? And I realized I have experiences that I'd like to share with you, and we can judge and be critical of them, have fun with them, laugh about them, but also talk about the importance of them. In the comment sections down below, please leave your comments. Please subscribe. Please ring that bell so you guys know when I'm posting, because I'm feeling invigorated this month. I am posting. Ugh. I mean, I'm just so excited for some of the content I'm working on. But with that said, I want to start with some of the experiences I've had. And then you can decide, are they supernatural? Are they magical? Are they like what is happening? And then we can talk about them. The first one has to do with my tarot cards. So my tarot cards, this is like a special deck created by artist Sarah Wands. She is the person who I also have her, you know, her paintings in my home. I have 1, 2, 3, 4. One of them was, you know, me kind of like me inspired mermaid, which is like beautiful. I have it behind me usually on my live shows. So you guys know I love Sarah's work, but Sarah actually made like a custom little tarot deck with her energy. And I just love that so much. And it has really, really helped me focus a lot of my intentions. But the thing that was so interesting about tarot is that I've been cynical about it most of my life, genuinely cynical. And I think the reason is because religion was for me proven to be untrue in an objective way, you know, a strong belief system. I think I internalized that for all systems and then eventually came to a place where it happened. Da-na-na-na. You know what? I'm just going to leave it. You know what? I'm going to leave it. Yeah, I'm going to leave it. I'm going to Kat Von D this. You know how Kat Von D has a whole setup of like wax and stuff? Plus, I know how to get wax off table. So I'm not worried. Yeah, we're going to leave it. Yeah, it's a vibe. We're going to leave it. Me doubting my whole life right now. No. We're going to leave this. I like wax so much. I think that's why I got into BDSM so hard. Like, I'm just going to leave that alone. Yeah. Okay. So I actually met somebody in my life who introduced me to tarot in a way that I could process it. So I have a girl who reads my tarot cards. She's been reading them for a few years. And she is a person who actually was one of my one-on-one calls as one-on-one calls as well. Like, I have been so blessed through this job to meet some of the coolest people who've maintained and become friends in my life. And so she was somebody who came into my life, has a former background like I do in Catholicism, moved into spirituality and reads tarot. And she's been reading my cards for a few years in every single reading. Has been so accurate that I have just been so blown away and therefore hold a belief in the cards, but really it's a belief in the subconscious. It's a belief in myself and a belief in her. What I really believe in is intuition and people and understanding of the self, whether it moves metaphysically or not. So you know, I've mentioned Itaroski a billion gazillion times, who created the Holy Mountain. You guys know that. And he himself reads tarot and uses it into the subconscious. And so I think about that constantly. I think about what it means to be a human, what it means to explore the consciousness, and what tools are we going to use to do it. So tarot really helped me process myself so much clearer. And it doesn't hurt that a lot of the future predictions made sense with the trajectory of my life. Now, over time, I'm sure it's been, I don't know how people see me sometimes, okay? I just don't. But I assume because I've talked about it so much, people might be like, oh, she's 100% into that. She knows everything about it. I actually know very little about the things that I love. I'm a very feel the world kind of person. Maybe it's the borderline, I don't know. But I try to balance the why of what I believe with how I feel about things. So it's not that I make my or create my values around the way I feel. I create my values around the way I think. But the way I experience spirituality or interactions with other people, that is a feeling experience. So when she read my tarot for the first time, I had a positive feeling, so I kept doing it. And it wasn't that she reinforced everything that I knew about myself, but she helped me explore the subconscious of what was happening in my life using those cards as a tool. But yet it feels magical. Do you see where the balance is so hard to maintain? It feels magical. The things are happening, but also it's hard for me to literally say I believe in magic still. So I have a problem with language barriers. I talk to tons of people who go, no, Brittany, it's magic. It's aliens. It's gods. It's all these things. But that's the thing. I don't feel confident enough to say that I know what it is, but I definitely am confident enough to say that I believe in the reactions to this spiritual moment, which might be placebo. So I understand that. It's like the balance between the logical and the feeling. I think there always has to be a cohesive balance to maintain serenity. So I'm trying, but I'm not perfect, right? Now, funny enough, whether or not those tarot, like the tarot readings are accurate or true or objective, or maybe they're just like a radical coincidence, I'm not sure. There is something to be said about meditation and ritual. There is something to be said about favorite items. You know, my mom growing up always prayed the rosary. I have very vivid memories of my mother walking across the acreage with a rosary in one hand and a shovel in another to kill a rattlesnake. And it's just very like symbolism of Mother Mary killing the, you know, stepping on the head of Satan. And so I feel this when I see my mom move with such passion around her religion. I see a belief that is strong and beautiful, same as I see with my Wicca friends. And I think that's why for me, I like to nomadically visit these places, but I don't spend enough time to immerse myself long enough to know too much about it. Now, that's what I mean to say when I say the difference between not my knowing and believing, which we talk about all the time on this channel. That's for something a little bit more objectively outside of ourselves. But internally, when I'm exploring spirituality, because I think it's so individualistic, whether or not I know something to be true or believe something to be true, it doesn't matter too much to me. I feel like I live in this gray world between the two where it's less important to me if it's real. Like, I'm not too worried if aliens are real. People are like, aren't you worried? Aren't you worried? About what? They either exist or they don't exist. And we've maintained cohabitation with them this whole time. And it's been fine. So I don't see what the issue is. If there's a God or not a God, doesn't matter to me. Because I am not here to argue with the truth. I'm only here to explore and be cynical of people telling me they have found the objective truth for something they can't tangibly show. Right? So I think spirituality can feel so real and be important to you. And it doesn't have to be something you can write down and hand to another person and convince them on the spot, this is real. I think we spend too much time, especially in the States and maybe even around the world, obsessed with our own narrative that we forget to be open to other people's. Why is it so wonderful to explore different cultures? Because you feel like you're learning something new. It's opening your mind. It's popping a bubble. Same with spirituality. Actually, here's the thing that I've been thinking about. Women I know, non-binary female people specifically, have a tighter comfortability or a tighter relationship with spirituality. They're into Wicca, they're into witch, they're into tarot, they're into candles, they're into crystals. And people have a hard time around that. They're into astrology, they're into all these things. I think women are just more open. I think females are just more open. They're more ready for the unknown. And maybe that's because a lot of us have been conditioned and trained to be quiet and listen. So we spent that time listening and paying attention. And we didn't have a lot of time focusing it on ourselves until, you know, that came about as, you know, that was accessible to us. And or you have a culture in which women are the focus. But I think for a lot of us who grew up in different cultures, like I vividly remember growing up, I'm Middle Eastern. I grew up with a really cool, very Americanized, but still Middle Eastern family. And I just remember at get-togethers, the women would go talk about their things and the men would talk about their things. And the men were talking about philosophy and politics. And my dad would like pull me over to the men's side and say, sit here and just listen. And I would just sit and I would listen and I would observe the men talking about politics and all of them having very strong opinions about what we should do about the world. And now, of course, the women do that too. But as a child, I didn't really think about it. I just wanted to hear the things about politics. I just wanted to hear men talk about ideas. I just wanted to hear women talk about ideas. And for whatever reason, my culture separated it by gender. And for whatever reason, my dad wanted me be a part of the men's groups. Now, I was raised by a really traditional sounding father, but actually a father who wanted me to work at 12 years old, showed me how to run a business, had a dream of me taking over the business like he did for all his kids. Like, I mean, I think that's really normal of immigrant parents to be excited that their kids will take over. But one of the differences between my mother and my father that I've seen in relation to spirituality or connection to Catholicism is that my dad, like many men that I talk to, have a little bit of a harder time vibing with the feeling of spirituality versus the ritualistic part of religion. So my dad has no problem with the rituals, very good at church, loves volunteering, very good at being a person in structure. But outside of structure, on his own, I think men mostly meditate in a way that doesn't look like ritual because they're more comfortable doing it in groups. I could be wrong, please correct me. But I do think that men are a little neglected in the spiritual realm because I think they're afraid to look silly and women were just all about it. And I mean that very respectfully, but I am much more open to looking silly doing a ritual in a forest than I think a lot of the men that I meet. So And these are mostly maybe, you know, culturally straight men or maybe rigidly masculine men. So maybe they have a trouble. But I think that that should be, I think we should focus on that. I think we should help men feel more comfortable exploring their spirituality the way that women can feel comfortable exploring everything from their sexuality to their spirituality. Women have had access to feeling and exploring feminine things for a long time because we are the feminine divine, as some people would say, even when we hold masculine power. But men, I don't know if they've ever been okay sharing that space, at least Americanized men. I can't speak for the world, of course, but at least in America and in the Middle East, I think I've noticed that men, there's like a disconnect, which I think causes a disconnect between the sexes, right? And I think that correlates to how we're functioning in society. So overall, regardless of who you are, your background, I think spirituality is accessible to you, but you have to want to access it. Like, you access it. The other day, my brother, who is Catholic, we were joking around and I said, can I read your cards? And so we kind of like read his cards together. And again, I don't really know what I'm doing. I'm just trying to figure it out. But it was really fun. And not that he believes in it any more than he believes in his God or anything like that. But it was an open space for him to explore that. And I thought that was really cool. Like, really fun. You know what I mean? Intimate and fun and important. Oh my God. So look where. So as many of you guys know, I did dabble in like the BDSM community for a long time of my life. I still consider myself a BDSMer, but I don't really need communities at the moment like the way I used to. I mean, 24/7, live, breathe, die, this community, X community. I don't do that anymore. Maybe quarantine, maybe COVID, maybe. Well, and I also moved in the middle of a forest, so I think that had something to do with it. But personally, BDSM was so ritualistic for me. It was beautiful and spiritual. It actually was my replacement for religion. When I was in BDSM, oh gosh, like from the ritual of what we would wear to how we would act to how we would perform even, like it was so good and helped me meditate and helped me really center myself. But what I recognized about BDSM is it's mostly with other people. And I did practice and do practice like solo BDSM meditation. It's like a little twist on it that I like to do. But at the same time, I do think spirituality has a realm of exploration that involves people and doesn't involve people. Involves nature, doesn't involve nature. It's just so layered. And what it means and how you interact with it is going to be so subjective to you. But BDSM was a place where you could go for just sex, go for just BDSM, go for socialization, go for friends, go for gaming, go for so many things. But spirituality and the exploration of that was so helpful. And I was a rarity. I would say that most people don't use BDSM as a spiritual mechanism, but I think growing up Catholic, you know, flogging yourself and maybe being bad and getting punished for your sins, it just correlates and overlaps so well. So my former religious BDSMers, I see you. I love you. I'm here for you. Now, the reason I wanted to bring up BDSM in relation to spirituality is I wanted to think about moments of time. You guys know that I believe life is moments of time, right? And so I tried to think of my spiritual journey in the moments of time I existed in. And I would say a moment of time existed when I was in BDSM and using it for spirituality. And now I don't use it for my spirituality. So what do I use now? I use ritual still because ritual is so important to me. Many of you guys know I do my day on 2-hour intervals. And you guys asked me to talk about that. It's about ritual. So my day is blocked out in 2-hour chunks. I have no idea what I'm doing in 4 hours, but I know exactly what I'm doing in an hour or two. You know what I mean? And the way that I do this is I wake up, my day is scheduled on my phone, and I say, okay, Brittany, we are awake from this time to this time. Wake up time is 2 hours because when I wake up, it takes me about 2 hours to get out of bed. I'm usually on my phone, checking emails, messaging everyone back, replying to comments, checking Discord. I just need something to start my day because we're in winter, because the sun is rising later, because it's dark where I live. We're about to hit snow season. We've already actually had our first snow. For me, getting out of bed is so hard. I'm naturally a night owl. I just work days because it works better for my work. Obviously, I take calls as early as 9 a.m. Pacific. So that is as early as I'm going to be functional. And that's even considered late in the business world, right? Normal people can start their calls anywhere from 7, you know what I mean? 2-9, I start at 9. That is it. You know what I mean? Rare exceptions, I will go earlier, but I'm really not functional. So again, playing to our strengths are so key. Because ritual is so important and I think it needs consistency for it to work in my life, the 2-hour intervals help. So next, I think about, okay, food, eating, exercising. And exercising doesn't always happen. Sometimes I'm not in the mood in the morning, so sometimes I do it at night. Like I did a little bit today. I stretched. I worked on my splits. I, you know, did some planks. I always do planks. Planks are like the easy easiest go-to thing for me. So it's a nice way for me to feel like, oh, I'm starting my day with something physical. Now, if I don't, I'll do it later in the evening, but same concept, right? I have certain things I always do. I made breakfast today, fed my little brother, called it a day, had a conversation, you know, nice stimulating conversation this morning. And that's always kind of the vibe of the house, is that everyone wakes up at different times. You know, I have like four of my siblings here with me, all boys, all fantastic energy, different variations of religious and spiritual belief or none at all. And so that's always fun too, to talk about these things and explore it. What does it mean for you to be spiritual? What does that mean for any of us to be spiritual, right? And how does it connect us to a group and an expectation of behavior? So in this way, I think my ritual hopefully conveys to you that I'm a person that likes to be in tune with my day, who I like to explore my day. I like to say, what do you want to do today, Brittany? You know, you have these things to do, business things, work things, appointments, but what do you really want to do today? How do you want to spend your limited time on earth, whether we believe in reincarnation or not, you know, which I personally don't, but a lot of people do. We still have to focus on this life. And in this life, like I woke up today and thought, what do I want to do today? I said, well, I want to make a video. I want to look really pretty for this video. I feel very feminine divine today. I said to myself, okay, I want to make sure that I have a nice, you know, table set up, which I guess you could say is nice. There's something very, see, this is what I mean. This moment, I kind of predicted it would happen. And at the same time, I didn't know what it would turn out to look like. And I think I'm fascinated with how this candle turned out. Later, after I'm done filming, I'll do some B-roll and I'll show you guys. But there's something very powerful to me to let things go where they're going to go. I have this obsession with, if it doesn't need to get fixed, let me see what happens. And if there's no immediate danger, let's see what happens. And yes, if let's say this candle doesn't come off this table, and let's say the purple doesn't shine, okay, I've definitely wasted like an $80 table. But at the same time, I need to know what happens. I need to know the why. Ugh, it all goes down to the why. I need to know why or how or what. I just need to know. I don't know what it is. I just need to know what's going to happen. Maybe that's a mental illness. I don't think so, though. I think that's my desire for exploration. My desire to see, well, the human discovery of trial and error. That's really what it is, right? We also want to have that balance between science and spirituality and magic, which is, I think science explains a lot of things. Some people think science is magic. It's all the same, whether you're watching Dr. Stone, the anime, or exploring it through Sabrina the Teenage Witch, the old, you know, the original show. There is a correlation and an overlap between magic and science. It's interesting. Even there are even like philosophers who have deep belief systems about reincarnation, who believe there's like one conscious mind. They believe like we all really are shared literal energy. And maybe we are, maybe we're not. I think depending on how you look at it, as an example, I believe we're shared energy in the sense that when we die, we get buried into an earth that ends up, you know, that energy goes into those plants and in all through that soil. And in that way, the earth is all connected. But I think until then, our consciousness, it's not really quite connected in that way. Though there are times where I've definitely been with my besties and thought, are we reading each other's minds? Like quite literally. Ever thought about someone and they call you up? Happens to me all the time. All the time. All the time. What do these things mean? I don't know. But I'm okay with it. I don't think I have to know everything to have fun with my existence or to worry too much about it. So, okay, let me tell you some stories that are a little wacky, but like could be real, could not be real, right? Like a little bit more extreme than the ones I've already mentioned, right? So sometimes on rare occasions, I will see like little black figures in the corners of my eye. And I know it's not psychosis. I know it's not schizophrenia. It's more like shadows, almost like children. And I'm like, what is that? And then like, I'm seeing it almost like I imagine them like Peter Pan, like Rufio, like the kids, you know, the lost kids. And that's what I imagine. But then I was reading up and researching it and found out that marijuana often does this. And I smoke a lot of pot, you guys know. And marijuana for me is part hallucinogen, meaning like if I smoke a little bit, I'm just chilling. If I do enough, I am seeing my thoughts. Now, I'm a very visual person, a very imaginative person. I lucid dream almost every night. Like I have very strong connections to what's happening and what I'm processing. I think because I was, you know, I am borderline, but I'm in recovery 2 years. For me, when I think about past Brittany and how irregular she was with knowing her environment, I can only think about how sharp I've gotten now. And I think a big part of that was recognizing what was real and what felt real, which is why when my mom asked me, have you ever had something supernatural to you? Happened to you, I said no. Because in my head, to process what was real and what was feel real, I had to cut out anything that wasn't truly happening in a distinct way. Because those kids I see in the corner of my eye, sometimes like, sometimes I think I see a person and I'll start talking like, oh, hey, bro, can you get the milk from the fridge? And then I'll turn around and no one is there. And I'm like, ooh, Brittany going crazy. But that's the thing. I don't think it's crazy. I think it's probably just like an effect of the weed and the acid and the DMT and the, you know what I'm saying? I've done enough drugs, not too much, but enough times to process that there could be a residual effect in my brain. Chemistry. You know what I'm saying? I'm not here to defy science by claiming it's something supernatural. I remember when Jordan Peterson and Matt Dillahunty had a really big debate over drugs and God. And how Jordan was sort of making the argument that drugs could be a god, but Matt Dillahunty is like, I think it's just drugs. But then you listen to Joe Rogan and Blair White talk, and they're talking about if DMT elves are real. And then I listen to other people talk in different countries around the world. They're like, this is how you meet the gods. I think we are all experiencing something that feels so much bigger than ourselves, and we are giving it a lot of credit. I think that's fine. I think you have one life, and if that's how you want to spend it, ooh. I think that's fine. So again, I just want to make it clear, I am not talking shit on your beliefs. I am not saying they're not real, and I'm not saying they're not valid. I'm saying that they're yours, and I love that, and I would love to learn from you. Actually, one of the things I allow my patrons to do is like read my like natal charts. I've only had one girl do it right now, and it's awesome, and it's fun, and I trust her to do it. You know, you have to give your birth date and your location, all that stuff. So I gave it to her, and it was really cool, and it's been, you know, it's going to be continually a great conversation. And it's not that I know too much about astrology or don't know enough or I don't want to explore it. It's just that I like it as a belief system. I'm happy to play in that playground. I'm happy to have fun and build sandcastles with you. As Dr. K would say, life is like a sandcastle, build your own. But I really live in a place that tries its best to find the most real reality, like the most concrete reality, and then allow everything else to be a belief system that I get to explore, even belief systems that I hold myself. The cynic in me isn't trying to say that I hold the most knowing belief. No, no, no. I want to remind you guys that when I created the observational philosophy of the levels, it was to literally explain this thing I was experiencing and other people I knew were experiencing, but it is a subjective language to discover what level of introspection you're dealing with, right? If I go to a Catholic and I say, hi, are you open to Wicca? And they go, no, absolutely not. Can we not agree that's a bubble and that they lack an ability to be a little bit more introspective, to question the church? Don't you wonder why they don't question authority as much as they should? Though my parents, very cynical, do not send money to Rome. Sorry, too much craziness in the Vatican, too many grinder profiles of the Vatican. No judgment on the LGBT community, mostly reflection on them saying they can't, that other people can't be gay, obviously. But it's an exploration. It's a question of consciousness. It's a challenge to beliefs. So again, there's nothing ethically wrong with exploring different spiritual beliefs. Though I will say, I get a lot of warning from people who believe in these, you know, ideas and concepts around magic. Well, they'll say, oh, Brittany, don't give people your birthday. Like somebody actually told me not to let my patrons read my star chart because they could have power over me. But you have to understand, I don't believe in that. And yet I sort of believe in the idea that if a person put like a bad energy curse on me, that maybe it would come back and I'd be like, whoa, what's that? And at the same time, I do try to do good and put out good out into the world because I think it's better energy. Do you get what I'm saying? I don't believe that if I give my information to someone to read my chart, that they can actually hurt me. And at the same time in my own life, I'm like, do not put out bad energy. Which I think can translate to be healthy mentally and physically so you're not a dick to people. All the same answer. All correct. All right. The other day, I was pretty stressed, but not in a bad way, just like in a, oh, I wish I had like 2 more hours in my day, just like 5 more hours in my day. And I said to the universe, like, come on, girl, give me 5 extra hours. Give me 5 extra hours. Sorry, I keep hitting this mic. I keep hitting the mic with my nails. I'm so sorry. I'm just not used to them. And my fingers are longer than they're normally. So I said to the universe, like, come on, give me a few extra hours today. I could really use it. And I didn't know and how I was going to get it. Like, I don't think too much. I don't ask specific requests. So, which is not always a good thing. But I didn't ask for a specific request. I said, just give me extra time today. And funny enough, I had like 6 calls that day and a bunch of things to edit. And 5 of my calls rescheduled or canceled for the month. And that has never happened before. Never. And I was like, whoa, what is that? And then the last call I had for that day was a really intense call. And I needed more spoons and we went over time. And it was like this whole thing. And I sat there and I was like, wow, the universe really like gave me, like they really, you know, they're the one. You're the one, baby. Like, they really gave me time. Now, again, I have no proof that the universe gave me time. It could have just been, coincidentally, 5 of my normal patrons who are always consistently at their calls canceled or rescheduled. Just, it's never happened before. So I was, as the kids say, shooketh. And that's the story that I told my other patron who said, oh, I think that's kind of it. That's like the universe. And I was like, oh, is that the universe? Is that magic? Is that what everyone's been talking about? Well, in that case, yeah, I've kind of had supernatural experiences. But let me tell you, my brain cannot believe it. My body still doesn't process it as like a supernatural experience. When I was 15-ish, I was really into vampires and Twilight and all that magical stuff. And Anne Rice, rip, rest in peace, my girl. And I remember being like really young and looking out into the darkness and always wishing a vampire slash werewolf would come, you know, kidnap me. I used to walk around my parents' property late at night with music and be like, yes, please, this is it. And I remember one time I was looking out the window and I swear I saw a man pass by. And I was like, oh my God, oh my God. I called my cousin. I was like, girl, I swear, no one believed me. I didn't even believe me. That's what I'm trying to say. Even when I see things like, oh, is that a shadow or what is that? I don't even believe it. And yet, it allowed a lot of like fantasy exploration, imagine exploration, a lot of possibilities that my mind didn't process before. What if there are people walking around? What if people are like Sir Headless Nick on Harry Potter? What does it mean to believe in something? What does it mean to explore something? How do you explore something without having a connection to it? A lot of men will come to me and say, I really want to meditate, but girl, I don't believe in God. Like, I don't even know what I'm supposed to be doing here. And I think you're supposed to be letting go of any kind of restraint on belief so you can actually play with the energy of imagination slash spirituality. What is the metaphysical? What is spirituality? What is the thing that we can't explain? How can we tangibly have rules around things that we can't tangibly hold or explain? Well, we're doing our best. You know, I don't have the answers for humanity, but what I do know is that the exploration into meditation and spirituality has absolutely helped center me over the years. A lot of people come to me and they're like, girl, I want to meditate for like an hour a day. And I'm like, an hour? How do you have an hour of your day free? I don't even have an hour of my day free to like meditate with such a focus. So what I do is I tell myself like, meditate till you don't need to meditate anymore. Usually lasts about 10, 15 minutes, maybe 20 minutes, but not really longer than that. I think that's fine. I don't think there's a real rule of how long you should meditate. If people are writing books about things that are subjective, telling you there's an objective way to believe in them, I think that's hard for me to process outside of a structured religion that is thousands of years old, so you don't want to argue with it. But in general, there's new age mysticism, new age exploration to spirituality happening every day by regular people. I'm a regular person, guys. I'm not some goddess from the universe, literally divine. I don't believe in that. I don't believe in that. But I love playing with it. When I watched the season 3, the witch season of American Horror Story, I was vibing with that season. I know a lot of people didn't like it. I think y'all need better taste. But I loved it, including the later season with the same amount of, you know, the same group of people. Loved that season, though. That season was all about women and spirituality and feminine divine, and it was dope. It was awesome. I couldn't have asked for better. But that does not mean that when I'm sitting in my regular room having regular conversations, I'm evoking the divine energy. It just means for certain energies, it's appropriate. I like it. I don't want to be not a part of it, but I don't want to make it my whole life, which is why, again, I always say I'm nomadic. I visit different belief systems. I hang out. I do my thing. And then I leave and go back to my farmland, my forest land, my like grounded energy. I'm very earthy. I love the ocean. I'm a water baby, but I need the earth to remind me of what is real. Actually, through my recovering borderline, when I did DBT, I formed an attachment to the earth, like a really, I needed a grounding mechanism. I needed something that made me feel like I wasn't going to die. Now, before I was diagnosed and before I got DBT, I remember when I had panic attacks, I would dive to the floor. I'd be like, the floor is real. The floor is real. And I could trust the ground. I could trust the earth to ground me. Versus anything else was so loosey-goosey. Some people would be like, you know, hold me. I'm a person. I'm like, but you might not be real. Our connection might not be real. And I was technically right. The energies in my life at the time weren't strong enough. The connections I had with those people weren't strong enough to be grounding for me. But my inner circle, they're really grounding for me. If I don't have the earth to dive into, I can rely on those people. But at the time, I just hadn't made those connections. So again, I think of spirituality and the metaphysical and all these things and energy and shared energy. I think of them as as like walking entities, but not literally. Like, okay, you go to the BDSM dungeon, a dom walks in, you know it's a dom, not from how they're dressed, their energy, because I know a lot of people who dress like doms, but they're not doms. When I see them though, and I'm like, ooh, that dom energy though, that's a dom. You know what I'm saying? Which is why there's a whole controversy in the BDSM community about is BDSM an orientation? No. Is it a belief? Yes. Is it spiritual? Sometimes. Is BDSM something you say you are? Is it something you do? Yes. No. Kinda. I am less concerned with coming up with an objective, cohesive answer to something that is such a subjective experience. And I'm more interested in exploring that subjective experience. Gender itself is a spiritual, I believe, metaphysical interaction with the self, the consciousness. You can take the grounding physical body that I am, this thing, which obviously appears female and a woman, this thing that functions biologically. I can make babies. I have periods. I just finished mine. I ovulate. I do all the things that this body should do. I have breasts that are grown. I have hips that are definitely womanly. I have a lot of things that, you know, people can see me clearly as a woman. Now, with that said, there are crossovers. There is a guy I just found on TikTok, and I was dying with them because like he showed off his body and how his like face is masculine but his body is womanly, and it was so funny and wonderful that he embraced his unique appearance, because truly they looked like a male body with a male head with a female body. It was very interesting, and I loved that they were like, this is just how it goes. And I'm like, exactly. So we don't always know how the human is going to present, which is why there's that spiritual allowance for gender to be explored in the metaphysical. So we have the grounding physical bodies that we are, anomalies or not. Then above that, we have our consciousness. When you start to explore the consciousness, you have the ability to explore the what if. And then the what if allows you to play with, well, what if I present like this? What if I am like this? What if I act out this way? What does this mean? Always against how it interacts with the self and the world. So remember, you are existing. And then you interact with existence, and then you have to have another conversation about it, about your existence after that. So when we're existing, I can process who I am. When this camera's turned off, I'm like, oh, look, I'm a Brittany, and I'm sitting in a dress, and my feet are dead asleep because I have bad circulation. Ooh, this is a yummy hibiscus tea. And I can start naming all the things within my immediate sphere. And I can say, this is me, and I know this is real because this is my immediate sphere. But this isn't just me now. Now I've turned on a camera. I'm recording myself. This is going to go to you, and you are going to have to interact with it next. And let's say I didn't dress up today. Let's say I didn't look like this. Let's say this is all crap. Let's say I put on, like, PJs, and my hair was a mess, and I was like, hey, guys, welcome to the fucking podcast. We're going to talk about stuff. We're working with High Priestess, whatever. Like, whatever, you know, it's like a vibe. That's like, that energy is not healthy, right? Sorry, I'm so sorry. But that energy is not healthy. This energy of like this box, oh, I love this box. I'm keeping this box forever. But it's like this box, I could not justify just like throwing it across the room. Not only because that stuff in it, but because this was just given to me and I've decided I'm going to take care of this box. This box has now become something sacred to me, or at least important. Maybe not sacred because that's a pretty strong word, but it's important. And I'm like, oh, I'm going to keep this because this is my first High Priestess box. This is a very nice box, has a very nice crow on the front, raven. I like it. I want this to be in my space. So I'm going to treat it with kindness because I want to preserve the feeling that it has in it. Now, if that feeling went away, if that connection went away, then we could have a new conversation in that moment of time with, does this item represent something powerful? Should I keep it? I just had a moment where I looked at my clothes and I went, oh, I don't identify with my raver clothes anymore. So I took all my raving clothes out, put it in a bag, took it to Goodwill. So like some teenager who's like, can't afford these clothes because these clothes were not cheap, can finally get them for $10. They're all really like taken care of. So I'm very excited for that future person to, you know, find these clothes. But I looked at my clothes and I said, oh, I need to buy new clothes, a new representation of this moment in time, Brittany. I'm changing. We all do. But it expresses itself differently. My ultimate goal is to end up looking like Frankie from Grace and Frankie when I'm like in my 70s and 80s. That's my goal. My sister's more of a Grace. But you can see, like, even now I'm thinking of moments for future Brittany that haven't happened. I don't even know if I'll reach 70. But I'm hoping that if I do, I grow into a person that gets to be that kind of old person. It's a vibe, though. It's an energy. It's a different form of exploration. And even in that show, Frankie shows Grace how to explore differently through the spiritual, through the ooh, and they like chant and they play with sage and they do all these things. Yes, that That is what makes me so happy in existence, is exploring all these fun things. Because for me, it is fun. It is so fun. And I don't know, you know, if people just have like a stunt and they don't want to explore it, or if it just doesn't fill their joy. And so that's valid. But for me, this makes me so happy. There's like a deep, deep part of my brain that is so happy with this. Kind of like when you throw a rock into a river to see how big the splash is, or how silent the splash is, or when you just break something and you see it shatter, like a, I don't know, like a piece of wood, you slice in half with an axe. It's like there's a sensation that happens that is so moving, and it makes me feel connected. Like Pocahontas, every rock, tree, and creature has a, you know, life, a spirit, and a name. I do believe that concept as well. I picked up this rock for a reason. I just saw it, and I was like, that is a unique ass rock. When I go on walks with my brothers, I'm always yelling, look at that boulder. Look at this boulder. There's a beautiful boulder in our neighborhood. Like, I love this rock. Like, there's just, it's so beautiful, right? I don't know why. It just makes me feel so happy. Is that spiritualism? Is that magic? I don't know. Is that the supernatural? So as you guys know, Avi, I grew up in a super religious Catholic home, right? Talk about my mom all the time. Talk about spiritualism. My mom's always walking into my apartments going, oh, Betty, I feel a demon here. And I'm like, yes, yes, yes. Now, interestingly enough, I do think my mom is like 50% right all the time. I think all my friends are always 50% right. I think everyone is always like 50% right. All people hold truth, and we all hold beliefs. And I try really hard to have a few beliefs and to recognize what I know versus what I don't. But I guess I do hold a lot of beliefs. I believe most people are good. I do believe like energy is real. I do believe, you know, humans are real. I think I'm real. I think I'm not in a simulation. I think I'm just like an animal evolved over time. But I have no like objective knowledge of this, just like a belief in these things. My mom has this relationship where, like, with God, with spiritualism, where honestly, it's hard to doubt her sometimes. You know, there's Saint Anthony, who's a Catholic saint known for finding lost things. And so anytime, I swear, I will have like a purse and I'll say, Mom, I really need this thing. Like, I need it so badly. I cannot find it. And she'll be like, I got you. I'll pray to Saint Anthony. She'll pray to Saint Anthony. And I swear, I will empty a purse 1,000 billion times. And then all of a sudden, I do it one more time after my mom prays. And there's the thing I've been looking for. Explain that to me. Explain that to me. But then, of course, because this thing has happened, my mom goes, see, St. Anthony's the real one. But then when I talk to my other friends who believe in magic and they do things like, let's say, read tarot or do anything else, they'll say, ah, see, it's the tarot. So it's hard for me to process that it's not maybe it's all the same and we're attributing different names to it, or maybe it's all different and that's why it's even more crazy. Maybe none of it's real at all. I'm not sure. But I will tell you a story. A story that a few people know, and a story I thought I would never tell, but I will tell you this story so I can be transparent with you. This is the most unique spiritual experience I've ever had, / supernatural. It is the only thing that I thought was quite interesting, but once again, my reaction to it might not be as climactic as you guys want, but it's either gonna make me sound crazy or not. So let's have a conversation. You guys can decide in the comment sections down below. What do you think? Okay. So about 2 years ago or sometime, I was hanging out at my brother's house. I was living with a farm brother, and he was helping me like recover through all my stuff. I had just moved out here to the country, and I was trying to get my everything together. I was in a really good space, and I was sleeping in their guest bedroom, and I had, you know, fallen asleep like normal day. Nothing abnormal happened. I'm in bed, I'm sleeping about what I assume to be 5 or 6 in the morning because the sun was just rising. You know how you just know the roosters are going. It's just like morning time. You can feel it. And so this morning is coming. I'm under the covers. I often sleep with like a cover over my head, or I sleep on my stomach. I sleep just like bundled like a wolf in a cave. So I'm sleeping there in my bundle of covers. I'm on my back, which rarely happens. I do get sleep paralysis, which I can, you know, attribute to just like a weird dream thing that happens. I don't think it's demons. My mom definitely thinks my sleep paralysis might be demons. So I'm sitting here in bed, cover over my head, and I feel steps on the bed. All around my body. Let's say the microphone is my body. Do, do, do. Footsteps. But they start from one and go to the next. So it's like do, 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 do. Now, when I sleep, I do lucid dream. Sometimes I have those moments where I'm half awake, half asleep. And I go, oh, it's kind of cool. I can go back to bed. I'm kind of dreaming. It feels really real, the thing I'm doing in my dream. So I started to say to myself, oh, you're dreaming. But then I started to realize, like, no, we're not dreaming because we are processing information at a very awake, you know, pace. And so I started to think, okay, I'm on a bed, there's steps, doo-doo-doo, there's a sound at the corner of the room, like, what is this? And again, I'm under my cover, so in my head, I'm thinking, okay, close your eyes, don't open them again, think about this. What are you doing? And so I'm like closing my eyes. I'm deliberately thinking, okay, let's go down the list. It can't be Indiana Jones because my cat was not living in that room with me at the time. She was in my trailer. It can't be my nephews or my niece because they would have literally said, Auntie Brittany, we're in your room. They would have jumped on me. They would have giggled. I would have heard children's voices. It's not my brother because he's quite large, like in terms of stature. He would, if he stepped on the bed, I would know it was him, but it was like light footsteps. The bed definitely sunk in enough that I felt it because I was on an air mattress at the time. So I was like thinking of all these things. I was like, okay, it can't be this. It can't be this. Can't be this. So then I did the thing every good Catholic girl does. Shema the Baba Brana Raha Kucha Ala Amin. Hail Mary, full of grace. The Lord is with thee. Blessed are thou amongst women. Blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God. Pray for us sinners now and the hour of our death. Amen. And I said the Hail Mary the fastest I've ever said it because Mary is like this very strong, prominent woman. I know people outside the Catholic Church and maybe people who grew up in it had a really negative experience with like sexism and stuff. But I'm going to be real with you. Esther, Mary, Ruth, Old Testament, New Testament, doesn't matter. Girls be badasses, bro. Girls be bosses. Like all the girls I grew up listening, like are learning about Joan of Arc. They're all people who are, sorry, hold on. No, no, little Nas, do not play on my podcast and get me demonetized. No, sorry, that was my alarm. but I grew up with really strong female figures. So of course I pray to women. I talk to women. I have a conversation and relationship with women who have come and gone. I always think of Amelia Earhart and I think of like all these women who've done crazy things. And I think like, what are they doing and where's their life? And are they dead? Are they just like, obviously they're dead, a lot of them. But like Anne Rice just passed away. And I was always thinking of Anne Rice. Like, what is she doing with her life? Like, how is life after New Orleans? Like, I wonder what she's up to. And she wasn't a very public figure towards the end of her life. But here she was, like the strong permanent figure. And now I'm wondering where Anne Rice is. You know, she's passed now. She came back to Christianity after she left the church. She had a real spiritual awakening with Christ. After wrote all those vampire novels, wrote a book about Christ as a child. Like, think about what she would have gone through. Think about how a woman who writes about, you know, gay vampires basically went from gay vampires to Christ. Don't you ever wonder what happens in people's lives? And it couldn't have just been because she was an intellect. It couldn't have just been, oh, she was afraid for her life, or it must have been a profound moment. I believe truly that people who have strong connections to their religion have profound moments with it. But of course, there are people on a spectrum who have less profound moments with it. So of course, this happens. I tell myself, oh, Farm Brother's going to get a kick out of this. He's going to call the priest. It's going to be a whole thing. So I wake up, tell them the story. My brother gives it a nickname. So we have like a nickname we call the little spirit. And we mention it. He goes, hey, have you seen da 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 in a long time? I don't want to say their name and evoke it, but also it's personal. So anyways, so there's this whole funny story around this little footstep demon thing. But of course, we called the priest. We had the priest come over. And I was like, what do you think it is? What do you think it is? He's like, well, here's the thing though, Brittany. You're a non-believer. I was like, correct. He goes, so if Satan wanted you to remain a non-believer, he wouldn't send a demon to your room. Because if you saw a demon, you'd probably believe in God. I was like, would I? That's the thing. Would I? Because what if that was one? And I legit just went, eh, must have been dreaming. Because that was my reaction. I was like, eh, it's probably just I'm dreaming, guys. It's not a big deal. Even though I do kind of know I was awake, I also processed that it could have been so many things. And by the way, do you know what I ended up doing after I prayed? I went back to sleep because I have a theory that if you make eye contact with the demon, that's when it becomes real. So I thought, why even take the chance, girl? So I stayed in my covers. I went back to sleep and I woke up a couple hours later when the house was awake. When I heard my nephews, I was like, ah, it's cool to come out now. Do you get what I'm saying? I operated with some sort of like logic and strategy against a demon that I'm not even sure was there because I don't really believe in it. But of course, as you guys know, because I'm obsessed with like mental health and psychology and psychosis, my brain went to schizophrenia. And then I was like, no, because obviously I can process now, but I had no physical, there was no like physical, like I feel like if I saw a demon, yo, I'd piss my pants, but I didn't feel that way. But maybe I wouldn't. Maybe if you looked at the level system, because I'm so open to whatever is true, maybe seeing an alien would make me go, oh yeah, alien. Seeing a god would make me go, oh yes, god. Seeing a demon would make me go, oh yes, demon. But then I think of anime and I think of the interactions and relationships they have with demons. And I think, well, if it was a really scary demon, like on Demon Slayer, I might be a little hesitant. If it's a cute demon, like on Demon Slayer, I might just be like, oh, cute. And if, especially if it was cute and then became scary, I'd be less threatened by it. But if it just showed up scary, like No Face on Spirited Away Miyazaki, I feel like No Face was scary, but less scary to send Chihiro because she had seen him in his other form. A docile little golden retriever. In general, I think it's really clear that we are all exploring and all having conversations that I think are the same but not the same. again, I don't want people to feel like, oh, I hate religion, or I hate this, or I don't hate anything. If you strongly believe it, I think you have the right to explore it. And at the same time, I understand the real world consequences and impact belief systems make on other people, which is why I always have to politically, of course, stand up against institutionalized religion or institutionalized discrimination based off belief, because we need to have conversations about how to coexist with our believed differences. You know what I mean? Like, look, that story either means something or it doesn't to you. I'm sure if I told that story about the little walking bed, you know, the walking bed demon, everyone would have different ideas of what this means. And all of them could be right and all of them could be wrong. I don't know what it was. I'm sure it was nothing. I'm not too worried about it. And I don't want other people to worry on my behalf. I don't want people to have anxiety that, oh, Brittany's inviting bad energy, or Brittany's, stop worrying about what other people are doing. Worry about how it impacts you, which is why we're open, but we have boundaries. On this channel, I am open, but I have boundaries. So I let one person read my natal chart. Probably nobody else, but I let this person do it because they earned a right to do it by being somebody whose energy I could trust. You know what I mean? A lot of people tend to approach me the way they approach people in their bubbles, but remember, not everyone is from your bubble. I most certainly don't live in yours. Whichever one you think you're in that you think I'm in, probably not. And yet, I like to visit your bubbles, and I want to always be invited to your bubbles. And I don't mean any disrespect, but it also means that we're going to have a disconnect about how involved I can be in those bubbles. And I think all of us have this to an extent. Like, my friend was an atheist or agnostic growing up, my bestie, and she used to come with us to Catholic church. She was open but had boundaries. Wouldn't come every week. My mom legit thought I was going to make her a Catholic one day. And I was like, joke's on you. She made me a liberal and an atheist. So it's funny how things turn out. And yes, people have influence in our lives. But really what people have is an opportunity to learn more about life, to have a more contextual idea of what it means to exist, and then what it means to explore the consciousness and what it means to believe versus know. So do I believe in magic? I believe in the magic of the high priestess. I believe in community, I believe in consistency, and I believe in structure. The three things all belief systems and religions hold to help their congregation and the people involved in them live happy, strong, consecutive lives. So, yeah. Do I believe in spirituality? Totally. Do I believe in a religion? Not so much. But do I think they're good for people? Yeah. And one last thing, I guess I just want to go over a little bit more is like the image of the person. My mom would be very upset if I didn't mention this. Clothing. Like Sadhguru covers or decorations or accessories, like my mother would talk about, maybe like a rosary or something of that nature, a cross, a scapular. These things are very important and they send out energy and a message. Again, how I present myself in this podcast can change the energy of how you receive it, but also the energy of my day. My mom always says, when you wake up, make your bed. It will change your whole day. And it does. It's so many, all through my 20s, I didn't make my bed. I'm just going to say, I did not make my bed. And now in my 30s, I'm making my bed. It feels really good. I try to keep my room organized. Does not happen almost ever, but I try. Especially after podcast day, this room is always a mess. But I try, right? I try to maintain a space that is a good energy. Living plants, candles, decorations, teas, candles, anything to help me feel grounded. Now, if you look at me, I dress very particularly today, okay? I did my hair a particular way. One of you pointed out that I tend to look like an elf when I do my hair like this. Thank you. That is the goal. What are elves? Spiritual, awesome, mythical, magical, ancient, wise, beautiful. Yes, thank you for that energy. I did my nails today because I wanted to feel very feminine and dangerous. You know what I'm saying? Okay, here we go. I wore this dress that I had just bought. I saw it online and I was like, oh, it reminds me of Sailor Moon. It reminds me of just being a goddess. And I was like, yes, I'll take that, please. These earrings I actually got from an amazing Etsy shop. Like, literally just spent so much money, bought so many earrings. You're literally going to see me in them every video now. I just, oh my gosh. The Instagram will be linked down below, but it's inspired by Mia and it's amazing and I love it and she's awesome and I had to message her right away. She wrote me the most beautiful card. She's actually a part of this audience, which is amazing. Like, you don't understand. Look at the art in my header, right? You want to talk about community and spiritualism? Look at the art on my header for YouTube and Patreon. Your art. Yours. My community's. The idea that I supported this, like this person came into my life, followed me on Instagram. I saw their work and I went, oh, I need this energy in my life. Went on their Etsy and literally had to purchase everything I saw because I just, oh my gosh. Like, it was so good. And I got the pieces and they're beautiful. The High Priestess, I cannot explain to you how impactful this has been for me. It's not the box. It's the people who put the box together. It's the actual dedication to the exploration of spiritualism and the metaphysical that I appreciate from the people who put this together. This is not just a box to me. And I've gotten, like I said, so many boxes. This is an opportunity to have solid connection to that one step close, like that journey through spiritualism. I'm like one step closer now. Yes, we need things. And I know a lot of people ask me, like, do I need to spend lots of money to have a relationship with my spiritual side? Yes and no. You need to spend the right amount of money. I personally think things like High Priestess, that's an investment. This is going to stay with me. Like I said, I'm even keeping the box, but everything in here was so useful. Actually, in particular, this book. I was thinking about this book, right? It's really nice. It's like laminated and beautiful. It has all these goddesses. It has all of this information on the goddesses. Like, here's Isis. And this is so funny because these are the kinds of books that I would love to just have around my house. Look at this. Look how beautiful. Okay. Like, this is a vibe. This is beautiful. This is art. This has everything I want. It has instructions, ideas, concepts, everything in one little book. Meditation, ritual. And when I see this, I go, this is it, baby. I'm very particular. You guys see, I collect books. I love books. I'm about to go to my used bookstore. When I buy a house, I'm about to clean them out and just buy every book. I love access to choice and information. You guys know I'm pro bodily autonomy because I think radical choice is beautiful. Having the free will to say, I'm going to do this with my life. I'm going to have this relationship with my body is so powerful. And I think that's all spiritualism. How you present, how you talk to people, how you use your voice or your body movements, all of that is energy. And I learned that from partially BDSM. I learned that from learning to walk and talk like a woman. I've learned that from everybody around me, that your energy is something you control. So be careful with how you use it because it's a very powerful tool. Thank you guys for being here. Please leave your comments down in the sections down below. I'd love to hear your opinions, your thoughts on spiritualism, magic, exploration. And thank you again to High Priestess for being with us for this video. This was awesome. I'm so happy. Please stick around for the end of this video because I want to show you what was in this box so you can get one of your own. There is a limited amount of them. So please, 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 please. It means so much to me if you would grab one for yourself. They're an Australian company. They're amazing. And I really, really, really appreciate them coming into my life so much. Okay, guys, thanks for being here. I'll talk to you soon. Bye. All right. Great podcast, huh? I'm so excited to do this with you guys. High Priestess is a wonderful brand run by a wonderful person. I cannot even explain to you how special this woman is. And I'm so grateful she came into my life. She's a third generation witch, psychic, and light worker. When I was first introduced to her, I was cynical as always because brands are always reaching out to me. And I'm always like, no, no, no. I don't want negative energy. I want positive energy. I don't like being just another YouTuber that gets chosen to push out another silly brand that I don't even believe in or use myself. But High Priestess has really impacted my life for the positive. Their mission statement says High Priestess is here to fundamentally change the societal conversation around the matriarchal traditions and women's engagement with them. I was thinking about old religions and even myself. I mentioned the podcast. Matriarchal figures impacted my life for the positive. So who better to work with than a company that's centered around that energy and then gives you quality products in a monthly subscription box. Like I said before in the podcast, I've dealt with subscription boxes in the past. They've all been lovely, but this is by far the highest quality subscription box I've ever interacted with. It is so good. There's so many items. Like I said during the podcast, as I was taking them all out, I was like, oh my gosh, like how many are in here? There is a lot. Something for the skin, something for the smell, essential oils, candles, something for the body. There's teas. It's a great example of a starter kit for that physical tool that you need to go on that spiritual journey, which is metaphysical. So you guys know, I do understand that there's a balance between the capitalistic desire to kind of sell you products to self-soothe and the difference between a tool that you're using and a productive way to move yourself forward. Spiritualism is such a metaphysical process. It's so hard to know what tangible tools to use to start off with. So if you want my suggestion, this is the kind of tool I use in my own life. There are other tools you can use, but for me, this is one of my favorites because it's, you know, it hits all the good parts. You get something in the mail every month. You get excited. It's useful products and meaningful products and quality products. And then, you know, the business is run by somebody who's amazing, somebody who gets it, somebody who's successful, somebody who has good energy. And so you're just, it's like a full on good circle. Like I said earlier in the podcast, if I see good energy from a creator, if I see something worthy of my time, money, and energy, I will want it in my space. When you guys get your boxes in the mail, please, please, please tag us. Tag High Priestess and tag me. I'm going to tag them on my Instagram. Please go to my Instagram. Check out the tag. If you're having a hard time finding anybody, look in the description. Look in the posted comment down below. I will have everything there for you. Please let us know when you get your box in the mail. We are dying to see how you react to it. These are real people putting these boxes together. I mean, they're really curating items. I'm gushing. What can I do? You guys know I never find sponsors I want to work with. So this is just such a cool thing for me. Maybe I just feel officially like a YouTuber or something. I don't know. It's been a long time since I vibed with someone's energy so well. And I cannot explain to you how positively I've been impacted. So I'm just trying to spread that positivity to you guys. Please check them out. Links down below. Tag me in your Instagram photos. And I cannot wait to see your faces when you get your boxes. Okay. Talk to you guys soon. Bye.